So as a girl that grew up in Canada, in Toronto, I'm just so happy to see this great event celebrating wonderful entrepreneurship and innovation here in Canada in a beautiful city like Vancouver. And I'm sure Nicholas can agree with that as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So this is just a wonderful event, and I'm so happy to have you all here because we live in this amazing age of compute, and that's the power, this AI revolution that we're currently living through. But that also means a lot of money is being spent on AI chips, and that includes $345 billion, $345 billion, almost $1 trillion that will be spent over the next few years. And that is an increase of over 75% from last year. And we're just talking about four companies, so the Amazons of the world, Microsoft, Meta, and Google. Now, what about the energy needs? Because I think we forget about that. Because did you know, and I found this astounding from the International Energy Agency, that to power these data centers by the year 2030, electricity needs will have to double to the usage of what Japan uses in 1 year. Now, Nicholas, of course, runs and co-founded a near $5 billion unicorn that's going to change all that for us. And you have some of the biggest hyperscalers as your clients. But we're talking about using light instead of electricity to transfer data between AI chips. So what do you think about these energy needs, and how are we going to be able to fulfill that if we want to live through this AI revolution?
Yeah, it's interesting. So there's actually two things that are driving the energy need growth. One is very fundamental, which is that computer chips themselves are not really getting better. We've had this idea of every 18 months computer chips are going to improve, and that broke down about 20 years ago. Today, the story of improving computing is I have one chip, and if I want to double the performance, I need two, and then four, 8, 16, 32. And that's one of the fundamental drivers that's making AI use so much energy. The other piece is that AI itself wants to scale in compute at a rate that's never been seen before. It's something like 6 times faster than Moore's Law. Yep. So a doubling every 3.5 months in the compute that's needed. So if you put these two things together, what you find is that we need enormous computers.
Enormous.
And the future of computing is really about building these data centers, single data centers, that use as much power as the biggest cities in North America. So the new data centers in Texas,
OpenAI,
right?
You're saying that it needs the electricity needs of New York City.
Basically New York City. Yeah. New York City's 7.5 gigawatts. This new data center, 7 gigawatts. You think about the scale of that. This is only a couple square miles compared to New York City, which is a sprawling city there. So there's an enormous amount of energy, and it's going to only continue to grow. Right. You think about that scale, it's going to double every couple years. 7, 14, you keep going.
Yeah.
Like this is how it plays out.
Okay, so we're talking about the AI chip race, and there is an argument, and you saw those NVIDIA earnings yesterday, that NVIDIA currently dominates the entire AI computing market, about 70, 75%, maybe even 80%. So what does that leave Lightmatter in trying to compete against a giant like Jensen?
The good news is we don't compete with Jensen or any of these other companies. We augment their existing chips with the ability to communicate using light. So we don't compete with these companies. We actually bring a fundamentally new technology in. For us, it's called Passage. And we stack the GPUs and the switches that are used to connect up the data center on top of our chip. So it's really augmenting people. It's not about competing with any of these companies. And that means that for every chip that they sell, we can attach to that as well.
But who's to say they couldn't do that in the future themselves? Or Microsoft comes up with
absolutely. Interesting question. Yeah. So NVIDIA announced a co-packaged optics technology, actually a near-packaged optics technology, earlier this year, I believe in March.
Yeah.
1.6 trillion bits per second. Also in March, only a couple weeks later, we announced a chip, 114 trillion bits per second. So you're talking about 70 times faster. So we're at a really different level in terms of how fast you can go with this stuff. And it all comes from the fact that we made this prediction of what the technology needed to look like in the ultimate scenario. And we invested in that 8 years ago. and started down this path. And it's just been, you know, a long cycle of iteration to get to a technology that can deliver 70x mm-hmm. in performance.
And what is your growth runway at this point? And of course, I'm going to lead this to the IPO question. But do you feel that there is a bubble happening in the data center space, meaning people are just over-investing as they usually do? It tilts one way, and then it tilts the other way. It overcorrects. So at this point, we're spending $345 billion per year right now on AI chips. Is that, do you see that being a bubble that will collapse soon?
I don't think it's a bubble. And I'm not saying this like, you know, speaking my own book here. I think that what's going on is these AI models are becoming increasingly capable. If you've used things like Cursor and Windsurf and all of the coding tools and agents that are coming out from these companies, they're getting incredible. They can code entire apps by themselves, just thinking for 20, 30 minutes at a time. We're getting to a level where the AI models are genuinely useful, and they're doing work that's economically valuable. It's not just like an augmentation, it's a bit of a replacement. And if that keeps going, like, there's no doubt the investment's going to keep growing. Because so, it's going to be adding a lot of value.
So are you saying that we're going to continue growing at 75% in CapEx, capital spending for these hyperscalers each year?
I think that the scale of the investment is such that at this point, companies are bound by how much capital they can actually
right.
outlay. And so it's going to have to match their growth rate and their revenue. And they need to see their revenue kind of ramp. And it is starting. They're seeing it, companies like Google and so on. And so that's what's got to underlie that growth. There'll be a cap on how fast it can grow
right.
because it needs to generate money to feed that engine.
And what about the geopolitics? Because this week, and I talk about this on television for the last few months or so, but the race between China and the U.S. And I was at Global Milken in Los Angeles, and that's all they wanted to talk about is who is winning the AI race right now between the two superpowers. Your view?
I would say that there's an interesting dynamic that's going on. I have a bit of a contrarian view on this. So what we've benefited from since 1960 is this relentless improvement in computer chip technology. You think about companies like TSMC and Intel releasing what's known as process nodes. You know, 5 nanometer, 3 nanometer, 18 angstroms, these nodes. They're coming to an end. And what that means is that the world is approaching a best known semiconductor manufacturing technology. And that kind of means that everyone will catch up in their ability to build these chips. I thought there was a result recently from China that was interesting where they took a chip that was significantly slower than NVIDIA, but what they did is they gave it a lot more interconnect, a lot more bandwidth to communicate between the chips, and they were able to achieve a comparable performance to an NVIDIA system. And so I think that there are new innovation fronts here, and we've got the end of the technology roadmap kind of pulling things in there and making it so that, you know, there is a final node, and there is a final
technology. So who's
winning,
China or the U.S., then? I have to push you on that.
Well, I'd say the U.S. has incredible talent, and a lot of this stuff was invented in the United States,
yep.
and I think the U.S. needs to keep, you know, pushing that frontier and incentivizing the smartest people in the world to come here and work on the problems. I think we're good at that.
Yep.
We got to keep that going.
I see what you're saying. Are you talking about revoking the visas for certain students?
I'm not talking about any politics.
policies. But I'm just wondering also, because of the DeepSeek shock this year, you know, some say that we probably need to implement more controls in terms of AI chips that China can access. But as you see with that breakthrough as well, when you limit a country like China and their access to technology, they will find a way around it. So what is the best way forward then?
Yeah, I think limiting clearly doesn't work. And people are going to find access to the technology. There's so much at stake for getting access to it. They're going to figure out how to get access. So I think being a little bit more open and just pushing innovation as fast as you can, that's how you keep the lead.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's how you keep the lead.
And from your understanding, you know, we talked about the diffusion rule, which not only limits NVIDIA selling directly into China, but also all these possible countries that NVIDIA chips could possibly leak through to get to China. I think 180 countries may not have access to NVIDIA or other GPUs in the future. I'm just wondering, from your perspective, have you seen any of that? Has that limited anything from Lightmatter? And your business?
Not from our perspective. I mean, the biggest data centers in the world in AI are really being built in the United States mainly, and you're seeing a little bit in the Middle East as well. Some very big announcements there.
Yep.
But, you know, I would say from our perspective, we're not seeing that as a major challenge. Google, Microsoft, Meta, Amazon, they're all in the U.S., And so that's kind of how we see the world.
Yeah, because the reason I bring that up is because Jensen, NVIDIA CEO and founder, he says if you implement the diffusion rule, I mean, that's going to hurt AI chip companies. Yes. And as you know, NVIDIA, if they're implementing certain technologies like Lightmatter, that also hurts you eventually as well.
Yeah, I think that could be true. It's a nuanced issue, though.
Okay. there's a lot of plus and minuses to it all. But I'm just also wondering, from your perspective, is the government doing enough right now to promote, not just in the U.S., we're talking about North America as well, because we're going through this tariff battle, which seems very anti-U.S. and anti-competitive right now, where people are trying to pivot away and say, okay, well, if the U.S. is going to behave like this as an unpredictable trade partner, maybe we can go elsewhere as well.
That's a big issue. I don't work on that problem, but I would say that robots are coming. I think that manufacturing may look very different in the future, and countries are going to have the ability to onshore things as robotics becomes really mainstream and really functional and able to do tasks that are more than like picking up a bag and putting it in a bin. I think as that makes progress, and it's going to,
yep,
you're going to see countries be able to make a lot of things themselves. So it's going to be a very different future. It's hard to predict exactly what that's going to look like.
Right.
But I think a lot of countries are going to be able to build their own things.
Well, since you led me there, I have to ask you, because every other day when I talk about artificial intelligence on our TV channel, people always write in and say, are robots going to take my job in the future? And will our future be safe, or will it look like the Terminator movie? So since you're the expert, I would have to ask you what you think.
Yeah, so what's really strange about AI is it seems to have come after sort of the knowledge workers first. And the blue collar sort of, you know, manually doing thing constructions, this is all really hard. It requires robotics, which isn't quite there yet. And so it's interesting how it's rolling out. I don't think anybody can predict exactly who's going to be affected by it, but hopefully it's an augmentation. You need to learn to use AI and get an advantage with it rather than just like letting it happen.
Yeah, so I told Nicholas also, because I grew up here in Canada, that my mother's with me in Vancouver, and she's disappointed I don't have an MIT PhD like you do. So thanks, mother, that's for you. But I also wanted to ask about Lightmatter itself, and because I think you've raised $850 million. Do you find it difficult in these uncertain markets right now to raise money still?
I would not say that's the case. I think in this area, and specifically on what we're working on, we pioneered this field. We've been working on it for 8 years. The investor interest is massive. I think 2024, we raised something like $600 million.
Yeah.
And so we don't see any issues on that. I think the investors are seeing the right signals from the end customers, and there's just going to be a lot of advancement here. We're powering the future of computing, and it's become consensus. It wasn't when I started the company. It's become consensus that this is the future, and we're the leader in the space, and so people want to invest and find ways to help us.
Well, you have gold-branded investors and venture capitalists like Sequoia on board. Do you foresee possibly needing to raise more cash this year?
Well, we definitely don't need to raise cash. We raised $400 million October last year, so we've got a lot of money in the bank, and if we need more, we could get it, but I don't think we need anything this year.
But it's also a have and have not type of market, right? So if you're in the right vertical, like you are in artificial intelligence, isn't money literally being thrown at you right now?
Yeah, but there are a lot of business considerations on accepting money and when's the right time, and there's a lot that goes into figuring out should you take that money.
Right.
We're extremely well capitalized. We're the biggest photonics startup and one of the biggest photonics companies, period, in the world today in terms of market cap and so on. And so we're very well positioned, and we have an incredible pipeline of technologies, not just about how you move data with passage for these AI supercomputers, but how you power them with light, the lasers that power these platforms, and a host of other incredible technologies that'll be coming out. And we're very well capitalized to go after that mission.
Yeah.
And so, there also are not that many people who are amazing at doing this kind of work.
Yeah.
There's just a few who graduate every year from the best schools, and we take those in. So you can't grow at unlimited rates when you're working on such a frontier technology problem.
I'm sure, though, being part of the MIT alumni network, it wouldn't be that hard to try to recruit from your alma mater. But what about the IPO route? Because I have to ask, since you're already valued at close to $5 billion, you've raised $850 million. People always ask me to ask unicorns, at what point do I get my money back if I put money into Lightmatter?
Yeah, so the IPO question is interesting. I think the IPO comes with a lot of additional requirements on me and on the company.
Correct.
That, you know, at this moment is not quite the right thing, but maybe soon that'll be the case. We don't have trouble with access to capital, and that's
right.
One of the things that the public markets, you know, offer, and you're seeing companies like SpaceX and Stripe and other places that are staying private for a long time.
I'm
not saying that we're going that route. Mm-hmm. But there's no issue with access to capital. I do think it's an exciting path to make the company public, and so we'll keep you posted.
Okay, so would you say 2, 3, 5 years? What's the feeling there?
Something in that range.
Okay, something in that range.
Yeah.
Because, you know, Stripe and SpaceX have been private for 15, 20 years almost, right?
Not that long. Yeah.
15 years? I would say almost 15 years.
Yeah, exactly. We're not going to wait 15 years.
Okay, that's interesting. Because there are secondary markets now too, right?
Yeah, so that's right. And there's a whole, you know, market for liquidity and so on, which is an interesting, you know, new development in this field. It almost feels like companies are pseudo-public in a way.
There are different avenues, shall we say, if your employees need to sell their shares in order to raise cash, because look, everybody should be successful and play in the capital success.
That's right.
So why don't you leave us with this, because we are in our final minutes. You know, in terms of Canada and what you see in terms of tech development out here, what has been your feeling in terms of what the country needs, what it's doing well, and what it could do better?
So we actually have a team in Toronto, and what I would say is that on frontier technologies, Canada is doing very well. Quantum computing, photonics, electrical engineering, software engineering. We view it as a hub, and that's why we've set up an office here. So I think it's going great. It seems like good incentives are in place for tech companies, you know, reducing burdens on companies for headcount, and also, you know, funding new programs and attracting companies to come. So far, so good.
Yep.
Just keep doing this, I think.
Okay.
We came.
And a capital investment in the country quickly, also in this new administration that we have in Ottawa. What's your feeling on what you plan to do in the future here in Canada with Lightmatter?
Well, we plan to keep growing.
Yep.
So there are amazing people in Toronto.
There
are offices.
Yep.
We're going to keep growing. We think the talent's amazing, and that's shown by the fact that all the top tech companies are in, you know, Canada. And so we'll keep growing that way. I don't have a view on how Canada should invest, but we'll keep growing in Canada.
Okay, final question. I told you they have amazing food here in Vancouver. What do you think, Nicholas?
I think the food's amazing. Absolutely. Both Toronto and Vancouver.
Yeah.
Maybe get some dim sum later.
Yes. Thank you so much, everybody. And thank you, Nicholas Harris of Lightmatter. Enjoy the rest of your Web Summit. Thank you.